All right, welcome gamers. This is a little Mortal Realms special episode, new and shiny. Me and Paul saw the video that just released today, the Marathi video, and thought we would take a few minutes, walk through it, share our thoughts. And Paul, the king of wild speculation, has some interesting ideas and theories for us. So the first thing I'm going to do is we're going to walk through the video, get a sense of, just the cool imagery that it's in it and see where it ties. And then we'll look at a couple of things that we found just looking back over the history of the dark elves and the elves, et cetera, and see if we could find anything specifically, any clues.
Let's break it down.
All right. So in the very first slide, we get kind of first screens of the video. We get a bunch of kind of Greek, I don't even know what kind of style of art this is, with the kind of interlocking geometric shapes, etc. But we get the voice. They call me the Shadow Queen. And so we feel like we've got a tie to Olgu. We got the realm of shadow. We've got these cool kind of Greek myths, these trees, these pillars, etc. And then it says that I'm the one true voice of a dead god. And I think it'll be pretty clear who that dead god is by the end of the video. She claims that I'm a demigoddess in exile, twisted into the form of my tormentor. I think we have so. We have some ideas there from the end times, and in the age of myth, going into the age of chaos. We'll talk about that a little bit later. And it says, and that devourer, or that, you know, twisted, says she slithered out of
the mouth of the Dark Prince.
Yep. The mouth of the Dark Prince, and we get this grotesque image of this giant shadowy mouth and these seeker demons kind of coming out of it.
Mm-hmm.
The next screen they have some worshippers, and they have some kind of models that look a lot like the Daughters of Cain.
Yep, and some death hags seem to be offering or taking things up the stairs.
Yep. And they've got they're fighting against some Slaanesh demons, and demonettes. And then there's also some bat-winged witches. It looks like above that is behind them is a Medusa. So we've got some very clear imagery there. And with that message, it says, I who helped bring civilization to the mortal realms and stood first against the corruption of chaos. Those are some big, big, bold claims, standing first against chaos. That's an interesting version of the story that we've not heard yet. Mm-hmm. But also this interesting idea of helped bring civilization to the mortal realms, because of some of the iconography that comes later. There's some interesting connections. She says, I who feed upon the offerings of blood and shadow, drawing ever near to my rightful place on the pantheon. And we get this imagery of Cain being surrounded by the statue of Cain, this altar of Cain, being surrounded by Medusa-like figures. So we get this theme is strong here. It says, for too long,
I have been shunned.
Yeah.
And then it says, I will not be denied.
Yeah, sorry. I'm just flipping through the slides in a weird way. And it says, for too long I've been shunned. I will no longer be denied. And then we get this clawed, armored gauntlet holding a very, iconic heart shape, with a rend through the middle of it, and we get these arrows on either side.
Very fifth edition Dark Elf to me.
And this, I had never seen it personally, any imagery like this. Mm-hmm. And even this, I mean, this is the Dark Eldar stuff or Dark Elf stuff that I've seen is very, it's not in the Greco style at all. Like it's, no. You know, and this, I made a joke, a gif on Twitter about kind of the Hercules Disney, you know, where you've got the characters
Hercules.
Yeah, dancing in those Greek pots, the black mm-hmm. pots with the, you know, that sort of stuff. So this feels a little bit like that, which is cool enough for me. And then the video ends with this symbol, which, you know, again, we're looking at out of any context or reference. You're like, ooh, what's this cool mysterious symbol? So that's the totality of the video, and very clear that we've got in the title of the video, we've got this is a teaser for Marathi, and it's her mm-hmm. voice through the video. This image, the first place kind of doing some look research, this came up on Twitter. We've got a picture of the Pantheon out of the last 8th edition Wood Elf book, where they kind of combined some of the light and dark aspect of both the High Elves and the Dark Elves and kind of merged them with the Wood Elves. And right, we've got, 22 symbols, which is really cool. And I see some inspiration here for my Drukhari drawn. I'm wondering if, either Mathlon, Lord of the Deeps, who in AOS would be, you know, Lord of the Heights, you know, wherever the seas may be, or there's Anath Rama, the Savage Huntress, or Kuros, the Hunter, could be cool emblems for those guys hunting their sky sails. But that's enough of that. I don't need to bring that into everything.
I got a quick thing for you though. Yeah. I might just point out here. Number one, I really like the evolution of Laura's animation style from the previous Mortal Malign Portents videos
yeah.
to this video. It was really cool to watch everything fill in on this like side scroller thing.
Yeah,
I thought that was a really, really cool touch. But the thing that everybody was talking about on Twitter, and I completely agree, is the voice acting.
Yeah,
was just monumental. I was so sold on the emotion and like just the writing, and it was fantastic. I watched it probably like 8 or 9 times just to be like, wow, this is some amazing voice acting.
Yeah, were there any other visuals in there that really stood out to you that you really enjoyed?
I really liked at the very beginning, it showed a tree with a cemetery in it.
Yeah.
It had these like little tombstones, as it were. So I thought that was kind of a cool, to me, reference to the death of the old world and the birth of AOS, because it talked about what she was doing, and then it starts talked about what's going on forward. But this path that keeps going back and forth, the maze, as it were, right, that she has to go through to get from one world to the next.
That's interesting.
I thought that was a really cool thing.
I like seeing, that's an interesting idea, seeing that decorative kind of striping as the path she took, her struggles. Because mm-hmm. you're right, you know, it comes out of, you know, it finally exits the mouth of the beast. Of the prince of the Dark Prince, so that's I like that idea a lot, that she's moved through, this is her path out, mm-hmm. and then and how she's served the mortal realms. That's really cool. I loved the art style of this. I thought it's very distinct, and I hope that we see quite a bit of this look and feel.
Yes, please.
In the army.
Yeah.
So looking at the Pantheon, as I got sidetracked myself, but
sorry.
No, I sidetracked into the Drukhari drawn stuff, but in the center there we have Cain's emblem, which is the same emblem at the back. Obviously we saw the Daughters of Cain type models. So the dead god that she is the singular voice for is Cain. Right?
Yep.
Right? That's what we're hinting at. Now, we, like you said, that glove holding the heart.
Yeah.
I just did a search. I just was like, hey, what is this? Because I'd never heard of it. I'd never seen it. And came across this wiki, nixbook.wiki.com, or Wikia, and Dark Elf Cabals. This was an interesting kind of find, and I'll show you kind of a closer-up look of this shield. And it's very much kind of like a clawed hand, very razor-sharp claws. Not much, as much of a gauntlet, but these claws gripping this heart. This heart is torn down the middle, and there's a kind of a jewel blood drop dripping from it. But what was interesting is that the idea of the broken heart cabal was that these certainly they're the social elite. They're certainly hedonists, but it's not just about, you know, the kind of erotic nature of hedonism, but they're the fashion, the crafts, the music, like constantly looking for excess in luxury. They're typically found in commerce and amassing wealth and building even kind of like corporate like or, you know, businesses, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
So that really rang true for me in terms of when she talks about building civilization, you know, that they were, you know, helped build the civilization. From the old world, I didn't think that aspect in the end times didn't come across my mind with Marathi, because it was mm-hmm. all war, right? It was all wartime. And the impression of the dark elves in the old world was they were just savages, that they just lived, like they just jump out of nowhere, cut you, kill you, because that, you know, and then they're constantly seeking higher thrills. And so this paints a different picture, even like historically, with the broken heart cabal, but even like what that could mean here. I mean, we're looking at a release of models for an army. So there's mm-hmm. now this broken heart.
Potentially.
I mean, what this is saying here is that usually the broken heart cabal weren't the fighters.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be kind of a something maybe going against that. But again, it's Age of Sigmar transferring into what it could be in Age of Sigmar. I don't know. What have you come across this the cabals before, or, you know, what do you know of this stuff?
Well, I know in the old world, Malekith and Marathi were kind of at odds. They weren't like brother or sister. They weren't mother son. They didn't have that dynamic. They had ruler. So Marathi was the ruler of the religion, and the religion was Cain, and Cain was death.
Okay.
So she had her own castle that was in a completely different area, and she had her own sway over civilization. Malekith had his own castle, and he had his own civilization, as it were. They basically were two halves of the same coin, but at the same time, if you lived in one of them, you'd experience a different world than if you lived in the other one. So for Marathi, one of the big things that stood out was that I don't remember exactly what it's called. I'm going to call it Death Day. But there was a day every year when, if you were outside, you were considered a free sacrifice to the gods of Cain. So the witch elves would just come through the streets, kill anyone that was outside. If you were unlucky, they would come into your house and drag you out and take you with, too, for living sacrifices. Malekith was far more obsessed with revenge on the high elves than he was with necessarily a strict observance of religion. Now, Marathi had control of the witch elves and the hags, so she was able to live forever. Malekith had this other power, basically just because he was the prince that should have been, as was revealed in the end times. And so it's a very interesting dynamic, because if you remove Marathis from the situation, the Dark Elves aren't really all that dark anymore. And if you allow Malekith to know that he was the true Phoenix King, and it was a trick that he wasn't allowed to become the Phoenix King, he becomes a completely different character.
Yeah.
So instead of having two halves of the same coin at this point, we have one psychotic half, and we have one that is potentially unpsychotic, right?
Right.
Which is a different dynamic than we've had for dark elves or just elves that are evil in the past.
And so you're saying Cain was the elven god of death?
That's correct. Elven god of death and murder. So Malekith, his worlds were far more about intrigue. You would send assassins to kill the people that were against you. You wouldn't send witch elves running through the streets. It was supposed to be secret. It was supposed to be hidden. It was supposed to be masterful. And that was how you proved that you were a good ruler. And he constantly kept all the other clans in line by keeping them on edge as to what was going to happen. And I definitely saw a reflection of that wealth and opulency in things like the Black Arks.
Yeah.
Which were these floating rocks that had castles and keeps on them that had everything of Dark Elf civilization within its own little island that was floating around the world that became these huge warships that would attack Ulthuan, etc. And that was how the Dark Elves basically would attack everything. They had ships, they had everything else, but that was the aspect that really, when you talked about the Bloodied Hand, that's what stood out to me, is these people who are literally the ruler of everything and able to maintain their own civilization just as exactly as they want to. So to me, that's the height of it.
You mentioned Bloodied Hand. In this pantheon, Cain is called the Bloody-Handed God. Are you associating that with Malekith more than Marathi, or?
Well, the Bloody-Handed God is Cain. So he's the one who kills, he's the one who sacrifices. But as far as you were talking about the civilization where we go for the excess of business, we go for the excess of art, we go for the excess of commerce, right? That was far more exhibited to me in the floating arcs, right? Okay. The black arcs.
Okay.
And in Malekith's world. So it was kind of a reflection of both sides.
Okay.
And that's why I said the both sides of the coin, because Marathi was all in on the murder, whereas Malekith is all in on amass the riches, amass the power.
Yeah.
And the difference is that the only reason that Malekith wanted to amass the riches and the power was to take over Orthwan. Marathi just wanted to kill everyone because she was freaking crazy.
Yeah. Well, and that's the sacrifice to her god, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's the sacrifice to her god. She was honoring her god by killing everyone that she possibly could.
So we got so that was an interesting connection. And obviously, I mean, this symbol could be really connected to the Bloodied Hand. There is also, I believe, let me see if I can. Because there was also the Crying Soul Cabal and the Blood Claw Cabal.
Yep.
So I don't know. You know, one's a military caste and the other is. Oh, I don't know, the Crying Soul, the priests, the mages, etc. So, there's a lot of history to play with there that would be really cool in Age of Sigmar. Now, let's go into that article that you'd found or that snippet.
That was actually. Book. Ren4 on Twitter had actually tweeted that out. So that's a cool little bit of fiction there. It was in one of the battle tomes.
Do you have that up?
I don't have it up at the moment, but I can get it up in just a minute.
I was just going to wonder if you wanted to read that.
Sure. Give me a half second here. This is titled The Lands of Grey Shadow. The being that awoke in shifting shadow was confused. Gone was his physical form, and only slowly did memory of the world's ending return. He could not control his solidity, which frustrated him. How long he wandered alone across a dreary grayscape he knew not. But he feared his fate was to forever be less than shadow. Yet as his anger mounted, his own rage gave him form. With his fury came greater corporality than thus Malarion explored the 13 domains of Ogu, the realm of shadow. He discovered many creatures, yet could find none of his kind. Only when Malarion came upon a glade of shadow demons did he feel the spark of recognition. At the center of that bacchanal was his mother, Marathi, with still flesh and blood, but changed. Theirs was a reunion full of recriminations and anger. Neither trusted the other, but an uneasy truce was reached. Together, they united under Sigmar, joining the Great Alliance.
All right, so that's cool. Because, and so this is kind of, this is the Age of Myth. He finds his mother. She's changed, but they're still allying behind order. So she's not I don't know about evil. I don't know where that fits. But you made the connection to the other side of this story, the beginning of this story, still back in the end times. And so what happened to Marathi in the end times?
Well, and that's where the thought process started with, I started thinking about the specific words that she said. She said that she was twisted into the form of her tormentor, right? So there was an interesting thought to me.
Well, so but what happened in the end times? So this is her coming out of, what the video describes is her coming out of, coming out changed, like what we're seeing here. Like he's saying she's changed. The video also talks about her slithering out of that. But how did she get there?
Well, and that's I had this image from the video of Dakala the Denied One.
Okay.
Dakala the Denied One is a special character from fifth edition Warhammer Fantasy background. She had a snake torso on down, but above she had six arms, including six swords, but the face was of an elven maiden. And because that video triggered that memory for me, I decided to go ahead and look up an article about her. I remembered something about her in the End Times. And in the End Times, she makes a cameo. I'm going to read directly here from the 1D4chan wiki for Dakala. So she makes a cameo in the last End Times novel where she mocks Malekith by throwing Marathi's staff at his feet and claiming she is Slaanesh's now. So when I read that, I went, oh, well, all of these statements make sense. She said she was twisted into the form of her tormentor. If Dakala had her staff, Dakala has a very personal connection to her, and I would have to imagine that she is the tormentor of Marathi. If she slithered out of the Dark Prince's mouth, then I have to assume that she has become more snake-like. Snakes have always been a strong aspect of Slaanesh's character, and since we have this direct connection to Marathi, or I'm sorry, to Dakala, it makes sense as well. Then it talks about her being shunned. So obviously the transformation that she went through was something radical. And then that last line, I will not be denied. Dakala's full name is Dakala the Denied One. So for me, everything completely makes sense. So Marathi has become the form of her tormentor. She has become the form of Dakala. And, that... and Dakala, it just fits in so well with the video. It fits in well with the Greek imagery as a Medusa. It fits in well with the Medusas that are in the video itself.
No, and I thought that was a great connection. Again, this isn't lore that I'm familiar with. And even that piece in the End Times, like, was probably not a huge piece.
No.
Right? Snippet on the side or something like that.
Until that point, Dakala had not been heard from 5th edition. And then all of a sudden, she reappears in the End Time to throw the staff of Marathi down at Malekith's feet and then get killed.
Yep.
And now we end up with everything pointing right back to her again. And let me tell you, how amazing would it be to have a demigoddess statue of Dakala the Denied One with the swords and the snake body? Like,
yep.
Wow. That would just be absolutely incredible.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like they could pull right from this image and create something that would fit in the Age of Sigmar. And
oh, for sure.
Just pretty cool. So, so the Marathi video, a lot of cool, just story and kind of just presentation. This tease of Marathi, being able to see, and. When somebody said, hey, somebody was asking a question about it, and one of the GW staff said, hey, pay attention to that hand with the heart, and so that led me off into that. So, I mean, we might have, these are Cain, followers of Cain, led by Marathi, who speaks for Cain the dead god, and potentially has taken the shape of a Medusa with six arms, wielding a bunch of swords, and fighting alongside our other heroes. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, just imagine an order-aligned goddess of a snake. From a completely out of Warhammer perspective, it is the Hindi goddess, right? Kali, I think, is, if I'm not completely mistaken, and no offense to anybody, but I believe that's the image we're also looking at there, that fits in really well, the goddess of destruction, the goddess of death. So it would be a really cool reinforcement of the idea.
Yeah, you got to be careful a little bit of cultural appropriation. I feel like this is heavy metal enough to just be its own thing. but the only other thing that we, like you mentioned, we don't know is that we're in the middle of Malign Portents, which is supposed to span the year. And you mentioned she's the follower of Cain, who is the elven god of death. Which I imagine would have had his own realm down in Shaiish, right? Mm-hmm. We learned from some of the Malign Portents that Shaiish is made up of, the realm of death is made up of the afterlives and the dwellings of kind of where people go when they die, of all the cultures ever known on AOS, in the age in the Mortal Realms. And we know that Nagash has tried to devour some of those gods and take over mm-hmm. their realms. And so Cain, although he's a dead god, maybe Nagash had killed him. Maybe Nagash ate his form here. Somebody on Twitter was talking about that being cyclical. So maybe he died, but he'll be back. We know that death is like one of those things that, you know, it doesn't stay dead. Death doesn't stay dead.
Well, and one of the other things is that in the end times, the manifestation of Cain took place in Tirion when he brought the sword, right? Hmm. When he pulled the sword out. And the same thing happened earlier on in Warhammer Fantasy background when the original Elven King pulled the sword as well.
Okay.
So there is this spirit that can come upon someone, both the spirit of Cain, even if the god itself is not present or, you know, not walking the land, as it were. So. Yeah. Now, there's a lot of interesting angles here.
Yeah, and so, I mean, Tyrion is not connected to Cain at this point in the Age of Myth. So
nope, he's his own god, so.
Yep. So that's what we got for now. Any other thoughts before we say goodbye and let people stew on this?
I don't really have anything else, sorry.
That's totally fine. All right, so thanks for watching, for taking the time to stop by the channel. Subscribe. If you're interested in seeing more, we're trying to put out some of these videos as soon as they come out so we can be a part of the conversation. Like the video, share it with other people, stick around for more. Thanks for watching again, and we'll talk to you soon.